So everyone who's gotten up here has said, you know, congratulations, graduate. I'm not going to say that. I'm going to say congratulations, colleagues. You are now public health practitioners, and that's really important, right? Give them something. So congratulations to all of you. To those in the stands, congratulations to you as well. Because these graduates, they're like turtles on a fence post. You're not quite sure how they got there, but you know they didn't get there by themselves. So thank you all for helping them get here. So I'd like to thank Dean Freed for inviting me along with the faculty and staff to speak here today. This is amazingly overwhelming and humbling. And I was actually in Lower Manhattan at a deli when I got the invitation via email to come speak here. I was with my family, and so I started reading the invitation to my family, and I said, you know, this is important. They've had presidents and ambassadors and luminaries talk at this graduation. And my daughter, who is 11 years old, looked at me and said, and Daddy, why did they want you? Right? Because nothing is quite as humbling as preteen sassy daughters. So she really wasn't wrong, right? When you heard I would be your commencement speaker, you were totally justified in thinking, who's this guy, right? You probably wanted Megan Thee Stallion, but you got Brian the public health practitioner. I will dance later privately for anyone interested. But I'm not fancy, and I'm not famous. But I'm something that a lot of the past speakers weren't. I'm one of you. I'm a Columbia grad, and I'm a public health practitioner. And I am proud of both of those things. You and I share a core conviction, a sense of mission, and a firm belief in the importance of the public's health. We share a calling to which you have already dedicated years of your lives, countless hours of work, and I won't even ask you how much money. This profession that we have chosen is both meaningful and rewarding. But making change is hard. You will face opposition from people and organizations that benefit from the status quo. We already know what puts people at greater risk for sickness and early death, poverty, isolation, injustice among them. But those are the same conditions that drive the wealth of others. We know that guns kill and terrorize Americans, including our own children, but too many of our leaders are unwilling to talk about that problem, let alone act to curb the violence. We know that women should have the right to control their own bodies and their reproductive health, but our highest court has taken that right away. Our highest court has taken that right away and left that decision to state-level politicians. As a famous New York City politician once said, we know the rent is too damn high. And we know that that causes homelessness, and it causes people to forego food and health care in order just to pay the rent. And we know that in one of the richest countries in the world, children will go to bed hungry tonight. And yet, we continue to ponder as to why we spend more on healthcare than any other nation, but still have worse health outcomes. Dismantling systems that benefit those who hold power is not easy. Where you and I see injustice, others see opportunity. Our nation has a long history of medicalizing and criminalizing our problems, and in doing so, shifting the blame to individuals and ignoring any sense of societal responsibility. As public health practitioners, we can no longer be content just describing disease and proposing prevention strategies. We must question those in power. We must actively and deliberately disrupt systems that are set up to benefit the few while harming so many others. We must challenge those who prioritize profits over people, those who would advance me above we. If our elected leaders and those with power continue to deprioritize people's health, then our safety, security, and economic prosperity are neither guaranteed nor sustainable. That's what we're up against as public health practitioners. But I stand here today encouraged because I know you are courageous and driven. You accept these challenges. You believe in a better world for everyone, and you believe that you can achieve it. And you're right. We have created our problems, and so we can fix them. We are not at the mercy of COVID or the next pandemic. We are not at the mercy of climate change or gun violence or poverty. We are not at the mercy of racism or other ideologies that value more than others, that designate some as less worthy or less human. We can change these things, and so that is really the question today as you begin this next chapter in your professional career. What can you do to truly make a difference? And so I want to share with you five practical tips. I'm saying five so you know when I'm almost done. For those who are bored, that's okay. But this is what I've gathered across my full career as a public health practitioner. And so first, I want you to really think about seeking real solution. Right? Band-aids and quick fixes, these are alluring. But hold true to the vision of public health. I often talk to hospital executives who tell me they are addressing the social determinants of health. But they're not. At their best, they are addressing the social needs of individual patients. Of course it's good to give a patient a transportation voucher to get to an appointment, but that doesn't solve the community's transportation problem. It's good to open a food pantry at a hospital that will help many patients, but that doesn't help with food affordability or access in the community. We get sick, we go to the doctor, we get better. And then we're sent back to the exact place that made us sick in the first place. Our approach to better health focuses on fighting bugs and bacteria while ignoring the impact of social and political conditions that truly shape our lives and our health. It's like a hamster on a wheel. We're just running and running and getting nowhere. When we're at our best, public health practitioners seek to break that wheel, to stop the perpetual cycle of sickness and healing, and seek to create a community where everyone can be healthy. So this brings you to point two. If you want to make change, you have to change the rules. And that means getting involved in policy. So I play a lot of Monopoly with my 11-year-old daughter, Chloe, and my 13-year-old son, Evan. And being that he is a 13-year-old boy, Evan's sole goal in life is to beat me. And he hasn't yet. And so recently, he was really upset that he lost, went to him, and I said, I have an idea for you. You know, you always play with the car. How about next time you play with the shoe? And he was elated. He lit up. That's great advice. And so next time we played, he took the shoe, slammed it on go. And you know what happened? I crushed him. Right? Crushed him. It was one of the worst losses ever. Because just changing the game pieces doesn't change the outcome of the game. The problem this time, though, was he complained to his mom. And knowing that the outcome would not change if we kept playing by the same rules, she came in with a whole new set of rules. And she said, listen, when Evan goes around go, he gets 300, Brian, you get 200. Brian, when you land on one of Evan's properties, you pay full rent. But when Evan lands on one of yours, he only pays half. And so, like anybody who enjoys unearned privilege, I said this was unfair. But it wasn't. It was the epitome of fair. Because the only way that we are going to change the rule, or the only way that we're going to change the outcome of the game is if we change the rule. And for us, for our communities, for our lives, policy, those are the rules. And until those are changed, the outcomes are going to remain the same. If we are to achieve health equity and justice, we must realize that programs and intervention, while necessary, will fall short of undoing decades, if not centuries, of racist federal, state, and local policy. Only policy can fix what policy is. And there isn't a person here today who isn't involved in policy. It's everybody in our field. Global health folk, the maternal child health folk, the biostatisticians, the epis, and everybody in between. We all have a role to play, whether it's generating the evidence, elevating community needs, developing policies, or conducting the evaluation. If you want different outcomes, don't just change the game pieces, change the rule. Okay, third, think about data and outcomes differently. Throughout your education here at Mailman, I am sure you've heard lots about data and evidence. In public health practice, data are often exalted as objective truth, seemingly reflected of unequivocal and unbiased experiences of human existence. However, data systems are not inherently objective or neutral. Rather, they are constructed and thus biased by the people, beliefs, and interests that create them. The very data used to track drivers of community health, such as vital statistics, census data, housing data, are all rooted in biased systems and assumptions. Mostly, we look at our data as ones and zeros, but we need to expand that viewpoint. Data must include the wisdom and stories of the communities in which we work. Like pieces of a puzzle, data contain vital information that, when connected, provide invaluable insights into the fundamental drivers of community health. However, when data are used in isolation and without critical input from the communities that they impact and reflect, or when pieces of that puzzle are missing or devalued, data can be used to create distorted views of communities that lack a real cultural context and contemporary narrative. They also can be used to fuel narratives, policies, and decisions that perpetuate structural racism and other drivers of inequity. If we are serious about achieving change, we must confront the ways in which data unfairly advantage some and disadvantage others. We must also reject the deficit framing that is all too common in our public health science. This group is more likely to die than that group. This group's more likely to have a disease than that group. I encourage you to take this whole paradigm and turn it on its head. I want you to start modeling people's resilience, their resistance against oppressive systems. Find places where health equity is least likely to advance, but somehow has. Find what makes that place different and replicate it. You have the power. Now listen to this. You have the power to work with communities to change narratives of victimization and vulnerability to those of strength and achievement. We should not be talking about vulnerable communities. We should be talking about communities and their strength and how they have resisted and overcome. That's our challenge. Fourth, accept and embrace that making real sustainable change only happens when you're working with other people. When we talk about health in this country, we so quickly devolve into a conversation of pills and procedures instead of a conversation of policies and partnership. I've already talked about policies, but let's not forget the importance of partnerships. I'm going to guarantee you that the change that you want will only be achieved when you're working with other people. This is change at a scale that will require different perspectives and combined power. It will require broad coalitions with people who don't typically agree with you or share your values. It can be easy, even comforting, to work with people who agree with you, but that might not always be impactful. During COVID, many health organizations like the Beaumont Foundation were working with communities of color to increase vaccination rates. But my colleagues and I at the Beaumont Foundation didn't see anyone addressing the lagging vaccine rates among conservative voters in rural America. So we decided to work with Republican pollsters and elected officials to try to address this problem. Together, we crafted messages, we developed videos and toolkits that helped get more conservatives and more people in rural areas vaccinated. Those with whom I worked and I probably had very little in common politically, but our partnership worked because we agreed on the mission and its importance. I know them now, and I'm sure that there'll be another time when our missions align. We'll work together again. Because what it's really about is finding common ground. An elected official may not care about public health, but they care about the economy. A business leader might not understand public health, but they care about having healthy employees. A school superintendent might not prioritize public health, but they care about students reading on grade level and graduating on time. If we are going to make real progress, we need to untangle the complex web of social and economic factors that influence health, and no profession can do this alone. And you will likely find yourself in some odd relationships and some uncomfortable alliances along the way. And if you don't, then you're not pushing hard enough for change. My last thing, got to think big. You're vital to our future because you have endless imagination. You are graduating. You have ideas that you're just ready to get out there. You have yet to accept the type of thinking that says, this is how we've always done things. Or we tried that before and it didn't work. Bobby Kennedy once said, each time a person stands up for an ideal or acts to improve the lot of others or strikes out against injustice, he or she sends forth a tiny ripple of hope. And crossing each other from a million different centers of energy and daring, these ripples build a current that can sweep down the mightiest of walls of oppression and resistance. Each of you can be those ripples of hope. Do not let the forces of oppression and evil starve that hope. And I warn you, as you progress in your career, as you get older, this gets harder. It's easier to go with the flow. The president and CEO of a philanthropic foundation, it would be easy for me to just go along with the status quo. I'd get more awards, I'd have fewer Twitter trolls, and I would be definitely invited to more parties. But challenge the orthodox. Stay imaginative. Fight the temptation to succumb to business as usual. Never stop thinking about what's possible. Okay, that's it. That's it. Pursue real upstream solutions. Yep. Change policy. Think about data and outcomes. Build uncomfortable partnerships. Hold on to big thinking no matter how hard it gets. That's like 25 years of public health experience, all boiled down to 5 tips. Listen, gang, you don't need to remember me. Okay? If you want to remember that I was like, you know, cool and good looking, that's great. But you don't have to remember my name. You don't have to remember the Beaumont Foundation. But remember these tips, right? Remember these things. They're going to help you. I'm sharing these with you because no one shared them with me when I graduated. I have the scars to prove it. I want to help you avoid some of those scars. You know, what public health has done is already outstanding and astounding. We have built a society that is safer, healthier, and stronger. When you think of the 30 years of life expectancy we gained by the turn of the century, 25 of those years was because of public health. But now life expectancy is declining. You are graduating at a time that is challenging and critical. At this moment of history, when the work is frustrating and bullies abound, we cannot shrink. I am counting on you to force your way to every table, speak out about public health, and help move us forward in ways that I can't even imagine. So class of 2023, welcome to this crazy life, this life that we've all chosen. I probably don't make it sound easy, but I do hope that it sounds exciting and vital, like a life of purpose and commitment. And honestly, that's all anyone can ever ask. I am so proud of you, and you all should be proud of yourselves. And everyone in this audience should be proud that you are affiliated with people who've chosen to dedicate their lives to help others. Remember, I'm not some graduation speaker, I'm your colleague. You need my help, not hard to find. Reach out. Reach out to your classmates, your faculty, reach out to me. I look forward to learning from you and being amazed by what you will accomplish and the world that you will build. When this is over, take tonight, enjoy yourself. Tomorrow, build the world you want. Thank you.